Early man came to what we call Greene County, long before recorded history, and brought with him a powerful, earth-changing weapon. The Dutch were the first Europeans to settle here. Bold and forward-looking, they brought with them a legacy of tolerance and democracy that were new ideas to other Americans. In the 19th century, Greene County surged ahead. Home to inventors, entrepreneurs, and artists that shaped life beyond county lines. Local people became national figures, and local culture became a powerful part of the nation's culture. In 1609, Henry Hudson entered the river that would later bear his name in a third attempt to reach the Orient from Europe. We begin recorded history with Hudson, but human prehistory began much earlier. Travel back 11,000 years. The great glaciers of the Ice Age are in retreat. Behind them come the first people to inhabit the land. It is a very different world from our own. Of huge animals like Mastodon, animals Stone Age men hunted with spears. Those spears were tipped with the first American invention, a spear point made of flint called a Clovis point, not to be confused with Indian arrowheads. Archaeologist Tom Lake and flint knapper Barry Keegan are in the 11,000-year-old Coxsackie flint mine. This was once the scene of intense activity. Men mining and shaping spear points. Barry Keegan shows us how they were made using bone and stone hammers and antler picks.
Here, I still need to bring this in, just so whatever wrapping goes around the hafting, it's out of the way of this cutting edge up here. So it has a little bit of a concavity here.
Coxsackie was among the oldest, most widely used prehistoric mines in eastern North America, where weapons technology was refined with devastating effect.
The technology was very efficient for hunting big game because of the way it was constructed, with the parallel flaking, the very sharp edges, the channel flutes, which we think that allowed a well-thrown spear to penetrate the thick skin and hide of Ice Age animals such as the mastodon and the mammoth.
All the giant animals of North America were eventually killed off. Science believes the Clovis point and ancient global warming may have been responsible for that great extinction. We know almost nothing about the next 10,000 years until the Mohicans met the Half Moon. They entertained the ship's company near the entrance to Catskill Creek. Among the things the Dutchmen noticed were an abundance of beaver, whose soft inner hair was prized in the making of hats. The Dutch built outposts for the beaver trade at the north end of the navigable river at Fort Orange and at the coast at New Amsterdam on Manhattan Island. Very quickly, the Dutch came to know the river. Catskill first appears on a map in 1626, named after the Mohican sachem Cat, who owned the land. The early history of Catskill became a test of strength between Brandt van Schlichtenhorst, agent for the land-rich Killian van Rensselaer, and Peter Stuyvesant, governor of New Netherlands. By 1643, van Rensselaer was dead, yet his agent continued to acquire land, now illegally. In 1649, he bought Catskill from the Indians and sent people and cattle there to settle. But Cornelius van Slyke of Brooklyn already held a title to the same land from Governor Peter Stuyvesant. When van Schlichtenhorst tried to claim part of Fort Orange, Governor Stuyvesant lost his temper and threw the agent in jail. In Catskill itself, the farmers that had arrived in 1649 ignored the squabbling and stayed on. It was the seed that germinated into Greene County. The next settlement was at Coxsackie. Greene County historian Raymond Beecher.
Peter Bronk was one of the earliest coming down from Albany, and 1662 was the Indian deed.
Mohican Indians freely sold land to the Dutch, often more than once, in return for iron tools and rum. Competition over land and trade set Mohicans against Mohawks. The Mohicans lost. What war and rum began, Western disease finished. Only 10% of the Mohican population survived into the 1650s. When the English invaded New York in 1664, Dutch rule came to an end. So did any true picture of Dutch life in the Hudson Valley. The English dislike of their competitors had a cultural slant. English historians in Britain and New England wrote America's history. They wrote off the Dutch as boorish and dull. But the Dutch were anything but dull. They were daring and rich. The Netherlands was the wealthiest country in Europe, with a commercial fleet larger than that of England, France, and Spain combined. In the years they were settling the Hudson Valley, the Dutch fought two naval wars with England over trade. They captured England's flagship, one of many victories for which the English never forgave them. An appetite for life was fundamental to the Dutch character. Taverns were at the center of life in Dutch American settlements, as they had been in the Netherlands. Court business, the business of trade, all went on in taverns. Unlike the neighboring New England Puritans, the New York Dutch did not hang witches, nor were they prudes. In many ways, they were very modern. Between 1662 and 1664, Fort Orange brewer and tavern keeper Peter Bronk bought land from local Indians in Coxsackie, secured a patent, and built a stone house. Bronk's home enjoys the distinction of being the oldest Dutch house in America with an architecture very different from other American Dutch homes or those in the Netherlands itself. Architectural historian John Bonafide.
This building, this is really an outstanding surviving example and displays all of the critical elements associated with 17th century architecture. What's unique though about this area, and especially Greene County, is the difference between its Dutch architecture and that to the south, that found in Ulster County and parts of Orange, in that the architecture beginning in Greene County employs stone gables. The use of stone in the upper gable is very distinctive once you cross out of Ulster County. Southern and central portions of the Hudson Valley used frame and heavy timber to frame their gables up. So these are very distinctive building types and should be considered one of really Greene County's jewels in the architectural category.
Dutch barns are also exceptional. An oversized variation of an old world design with great H-shaped anchor beams supporting the roof. Ted Hilscher is a professor of history at Columbia Greene College.
The main characteristic of a Dutch barn are going to be the H's. The H's, you have one right here behind me. There's five of them that support the roof in this building. And what happens here is the H at the top of the post over here, this is a post, is a purlin. That purlin, almost 50 feet long, is supported every 16 feet by a post, holds up the roof on this side.
The same year Peter Bronk built his house, English warships sailed into New Amsterdam. The Duke of Albany, tricked out as a Roman conqueror and soon to be King James II, claimed the New Netherlands for England. 23 years later, the Dutch returned the favor. Dutchman William III invaded England and deposed James II. The English termed the event the Glorious Revolution. Glorious it was not, except for the Dutch. In Albany, the Dutch paraded in triumph. In 1673, Dutch forces had briefly retaken the colony. Now they had a Dutch king.
Als dat zo is, dan zijn we eindelijk van ze af.
In Catskill and Coxsackie, Dutchmen saluted William III. The Netherlands had long been a refuge for religious dissenters and foreign exiles. The Dutch took that diversity to the Hudson Valley. In Greene County, there were Swedes like the Bronx, Norwegians that had taken Dutch names like the Van der Zees, and much persecuted French Huguenots like the Dubois family. Germans from the Palatine state came in great numbers in 1710. They found a friend in Queen Anne, but also in Indians visiting Anne's court, who offered them land south of the Mohawk Valley. Along the Hudson, other Dutch settlements arose. The Van Slykes began to farm at what would become New Baltimore, and Jan van Loon put down his roots at what would become Athens. Meanwhile, the Catskill Mountains remained trackless. Settlers feared the mountains for real reasons, but also as their forefathers had taught them, mountains were often the home of strange beings. Forbidding image of the Catskills began to fade when America's pioneer plant collector John Bartram and his son William visited Catskill Falls in 1741. Europe was excited by his shipments of exotic plants and reports of wild rivers. The raw beauty of the Catskills, and by extension all of America's wilderness, had found a prophetic voice in Bartram. First in his discoveries, and later in Hudson River art, wilderness would define America to the world. By the 1770s, America's old grievances over trade with Britain ignited in conflict, and not just in Boston. In the upper Hudson Valley, opposition between loyalists to the crown, Tories, and patriots had created dangerous choices for both groups. Patriot Dominee Johannes Schunemann was despised and threatened by local Tories.
En leid ons niet in verzoeking, maar verlos ons van de boze. Want aan u is het koninkrijk.
His musket never left his side.
En de heerlijkheid in der eeuwigheid. Amen.
Called the Fighting Dominie, Schunemann was responsible for the Coxsackie Declaration, which opposed unfair British trade laws, but also appealed for reconciliation. It was written a year before Thomas Jefferson's Declaration of Independence, a document which itself had deep roots in Dutch history. The document was signed at the home of Leonard Bronk. Bronk was head of the local committee of correspondence. The committee and the document obliged citizens to declare their loyalty. 225 men signed it. They did so at their peril, from fellow patriots if they did not, and from the crown when they did. No battles were fought here, but there was a skulking guerrilla war of murderers and kidnappings by a Tory cavalry troop called Delancey's Light Horse. They were also called cowboys because they sold stolen livestock to the British. They sometimes killed patriot farmers or sold them into service to the crown. David Abiel had built a manor house outside Catskill at what was called the back oven. He was a magistrate and an outspoken patriot. He would pay a price for his loyalties. Many people had slaves, and slaves became pawns in the war.
Mm-hmm.
The British promised the slaves their freedom if they would turn on their American masters. And many did.
It's not drying right.
I'll smoke it then.
Catherine,
put that down.
Tory raiding parties were a mix of Mohawks and Tory settlers who often wore face paint.
Jacobus Rowe, you're a sorry.
Jacobus Rowe was notorious.
You're the one who.
He told Abiel he was taking him to the British at Niagara, and his son to forced service as a soldier for the crown.
Rebels, traitor.
What do you want here?
The crown will pay for that, boy.
I won't.
Anthony Abiel refused to fight for the king. A Mohawk threatened to kill him if he wouldn't fight.
I'll fight for King George. He promised freedom.
Tie them up.
Lon had betrayed the Abiels to the raiding party and now would join them. Kathy Abiel would go down in history for saving her father's and brother's silver shoe buckles from the raiding party.
There are some things they'll not steal.
What are you doing with my stick? I'm master now. And you can wear this, and I'll wear this. You can eat that swill you gave me.
The Tory captain and his Mohawk allies marched this little party to Fort Niagara, hundreds of miles away. They released David en route, but his son Anthony spent a year in service before escaping. There is no further record of Lon. The war went on for 7 years. It might have gone on longer were it not for Nathaniel Greene, a Rhode Island general who saw Greene County briefly once. General Greene turned the tide of the revolution at Guilford Courthouse, a remote little battlefield in North Carolina. The British were led by Cornwallis, Britain's prize commander. His veteran troops charged the Americans three times, and three times the Americans fell back. Greene County Historical Society President Bob Halleck presents the secret of Greene's success to fourth graders at Coxsackie Grade School.
When Greene arrived in the South, he discovered that he was outnumbered by the British soldiers, so he had to develop tactics that would help defeat the British, and you will see why Greene is considered to be the hero of the South and one of the major reasons that the Americans won the Revolution. Line one, advance, kneel, fire. Line two, advance, kneel, fire. Line three, advance, kneel, fire. Sharpshooters. And the British are victorious.
The Americans retreated three times, but they left the field littered with English dead, far more than the casualties they suffered.
As you can see, the British think they have won the Battle of Guilford Courthouse. But as the war continues throughout the South, Greene drags Cornwallis away from the coast, away from his supplies, until eventually he has to surrender at Yorktown to George Washington. As Greene is often quoted, "We fight, get beat, get up, and fight again."
A grateful nation thanked Greene by putting his name time and again on towns, roads, buildings, and counties across the nation. As the Revolution came to a close, new towns were organized where there had only been pioneer settlements. Immigrants came in search of empty land. They came from New England and Dutchess and Westchester counties. They had been broken by taxes, were resentful of authority, some would say lawless, such as those who had been part of Shay's rebellion against taxes in Massachusetts. Social justice and tolerance were old ideas, but rarely practiced. They were scarcely acknowledged 200 years ago, certainly not at Salisbury Manor. A young servant left Salisbury Manor one evening to spend time with friends, but without her master's permission. Salisbury and his men went after her. He dragged her home on the end of a rope, and she died of her wounds. William Salisbury was found guilty of murder. His family's position saved him from the gallows, but he was sentenced to wear a noose around his neck until he was 99. If he lived longer, he was to be hanged. Salisbury lived to be over 100, but the new court relented and he did not hang. Many of the New Englanders brought with them the narrow views of the old Puritans. Minding your neighbor's business was an ingrained principle in many of their congregations. Silas Strong was a Durham Presbyterian. He got drunk and had seizures, devilish acts in the eyes of his congregation. The deacons wrote to him,
"Place yourself, my brother, before you act, before the bar of your heavenly judge."
And then dismissed him from the church to live as an exile. The old fear of witchcraft, or even ordinary human failings, would take still more generations to dispel. The Durham Presbyterians were not alone. Tolerance among and within most churches was rare. The Stanton Hill Cemetery in New Baltimore is the resting place of many Quakers. These grade schoolers have learned how Quakers who practiced tolerance were victimized for it.
I also heard that Quakers were sometimes expelled from places like Massachusetts.
Yes, because they didn't belong.
Oh yeah, and some Puritans, yeah. Yes.
Oh, cool.
In Massachusetts. Wait. Expelled them, called them witches.
Benjamin Lisk was a well-to-do Quaker farmer. The New Baltimore Quakers were split between reformers and traditionalists like Lisk. Both sides managed to keep their religion simple, but not tolerant of one another.
No sermons, no lessons, no priest.
Gee, sounds okay.
But things were not okay back then. Sympathy for the underdog, tolerance of religious differences, would be a long time coming. The new century came in with the election of Thomas Jefferson as president. The same year, the New York legislature declared Greene a new county. The next 100 years would usher in many new towns and great progress. A year later, Ira Day built a mill at Catskill that could grind 500 to 600 bushels of wheat a day, a seminal moment in the life of the county.
Wanted. 10 or 15 sworn turnpikers to whom good wages will be given. No Dutchman need apply unless he is pretty well Yankeefied, and no Irishman unless he can demolish a quart of rum per day.
A new turnpike was built to bring wheat from Waddell's Ferry in the grain-producing regions along the Susquehanna River to Catskill, where it was ground and shipped up, down, and across the river to Connecticut. The turnpike in the mill catapulted the sleepy river town into a historic role as the key port between New York City and Albany.
Once the turnpike opened up, you had a tremendous number of people using Catskill as one of the main inland ports on the Hudson River. And it brought in not only merchandise from the western part of the state to be shipped out, but also products coming in, manufactured. Merchandise coming in, which would be shipped out as far as Gilboa and places in the other counties. Tremendous amount of development, economic resources.
Catskill enjoyed its trade monopoly until 1825, but the new Erie Canal ended that by providing a quicker water route from central New York to the Hudson. Catskill then planned its own canal to Canajoharie that would provide an even shorter route to the Hudson, but the financing failed. Still not beaten, Catskill tried to build a railroad in place of the canal. This time, the roadbed failed and laid the railroad low. But other determined men and projects were forging ahead. The War of 1812 had been fought mostly at sea and the Great Lakes, and the Navy needed oars. A young Greene County entrepreneur, Zadok Pratt, provided 12,000, launching a remarkable career. Tanning leather was the Catskills' first industry. Hemlock bark provided the essential tanning ingredient, and hemlock was everywhere. Pratt built the largest tannery in the world, for which he bought and cut 10,000 acres of hemlock. He laid out a street grid and built a village of 100 houses, a school, roads, a bank, and several churches. He also invested in newspapers, milliner's shops, harness makers, drug stores. Pratt also loved a good time. Three times a militia colonel, he entertained Prattsville by staging comic Napoleonic battles. Pratt would dress up as Napoleon and his men as soldiers and attack a barn with muskets and a field piece. The town loved it. Pratt shaped the ideal of a practical genius that Americans so admired. As a congressman, he helped found the Smithsonian, the Bureau of Standards, and a railroad route to the Pacific. To the people of Greene County, Pratt was a living symbol of America's expanding destiny. After the beaver trade, farming became the way to make a living. But alongside animals, fruit, and grain, kernels of inventive genius were also sprouting. Photography was in its infancy, and Greene County came in with the baby. Matthias Van Loan of Athens is thought to have made America's first daguerreotypes, one of the earliest forms of photography. Daguerreotypists everywhere were thriving as people flocked to have their image captured. The search for color photography was already on when, suddenly, Levi Hill, a country preacher in Westkill, New York, announced he had found the chemical formula for color photography. He shared it with Samuel F.B. Morse, inventor of the telegraph, and Zadok Pratt, but refused to make it public for fear it would be stolen. His secret lay at the molecular level.
On this one thing, molecular arrangement, the whole
today, Hill is accepted as the inventor of color film, but at the time, most people did not believe him, especially other daguerreotypists. Since he offered no public proof, he was accused of concocting a good story in order to put his competition out of business. He fought back, attacked his critics, feared for his own safety. His work has been preserved, but just barely. It's not beautiful, but it is in color. A flood of new inventions characterized the 19th century, and many were invented here. The father of the skyscraper was born and raised in Catskill. James Bogardus erected the world's first tall iron building in New York City, where it would serve as the model for all future skyscrapers. William Bullock of Catskill was another prodigal mechanic, an inventor of printing machines. In an age when popular magazines first appeared, popular because they had pictures. These became national publications in part because of Bullock's high-speed rotary press, printing and cutting between 12,000 and 30,000 sheets an hour. There was also a richness of established industries. The Clark Pottery was the largest in the nation. There were shipyards, brickyards, ice cutting. Even the bees worked marvels in Greene County. Honey Hollow was the home of Moses Quimby, the father of American beekeeping. He was the nation's largest producer of honey. He once sent so much honey to New York City that it broke the market price. And new industry kept popping up in the most improbable places. America built its first malleable ironworks, an early form of steel, in Oak Hill. Revolutionary in its applications, it was first manufactured by Calvin Adams in 1833. Josiah Dutcher of Oak Hill had already developed a malleable iron plow that would not break in New York's rocky ground. He did so in 1819, years before John Deere brought out his steel plow. A man's house testified to his importance. Oak Hill's inventive foundrymen left behind three striking houses. Calvin Adams built the whimsical Icicle House early in the 19th century. Architecturally, it's in a class of its own. The Tripp House is elegant, a model of crisp federal architecture.
The federal period as found in the Tripp House is exemplified by its entry, which includes these beautifully attenuated posts supporting a compound cornice, and that cornice is then covered by a very delicately designed fanlight, which includes cast iron tracery and a variety of carved detail, really making the trip house one of the finest examples of this very high and delicate style.
Greek Revival is the richest architectural tradition in Greene County. And a classic example is the beautifully designed home of Charles Pierce.
When we talk about Greek Revival architecture, we talk about elements such as you see here spanning the front of the Pierce House. We have this massive wooden tablature that's being held up by these overscaled columns. The columns, Ionic in order, that's these scrolled capitals we see, these beautiful two-story fluted columns supporting this whole piece intended to replicate the design of ancient Greek temples. And in a house of this scale, that is a remarkable kind of element to have in a small community like this. And we also want to look at the balustrade that spans the front of this porch with these iron grills. Pierce was an iron maker. His industry was a foundry industry. He was casting this kind of work, and he's showing it off in his own house.
The county's output of iron and steel included weapons, and Catskill produced the popular knuckle duster. It got its name because it also served as an excellent set of brass knuckles. The American Romantic movement in the arts and literature drew its first breath in Greene County's Catskill Mountains. Nature was the great teacher here. Painter Thomas Cole's vision of nature would establish the first American school of art, the Hudson River School. Of all that great artistic outpouring, there are few more vivid works than Kindred Spirits, Asher Duran's leafy dream of Catskill Clove. At its center are painter Thomas Cole and writer William Cullen Bryant. David Barnes and Betsy Jacks of the Thomas Cole National Historic Site in Catskill join painters that are still capturing the elemental beauty of the landscape. The painters' works are all very different from one another. But, like Thomas Cole, they interpret what they believe to be true to nature.
Oh, it's amazing to watch the process. And it reminded me of the way the Hudson River School painters must have also done that. I mean, they speak always in their writings about truth and beauty and being true to nature. And to be in the landscape that inspires them today suddenly reminds me, yes, that's what they wanted us to get from those paintings. The funny thing, though, is it takes probably another 20 years before other landscape painters join in. Cole is really a pioneer in that sense, in that he brings that sense of American wilderness to the fore and then toils in it by himself for over a decade before other painters start to take it on.
Thomas Cole reinvented wilderness. He saw it not as some Europeans had, as fearful or a wasteland, but as a unique vision of beauty. Yet Cole did not know the Catskills as we do, but with large areas cut and burned over by the tanners. The destruction angered him, but it also concentrated his desire to preserve tracts of beautiful wilderness. Cole treasured the variety of natural forms, endless and unpredictable. Working from his field sketches, Cole painted in his studio. His first successes were Catterskill Falls and Lake with Dead Trees. They are asymmetrical, true to nature, so unlike the older tradition of perfectly contrived landscapes. It is that truth that captivated America's leading artist, John Trumbull, who launched the young artist in his career. Cole painted Catterskill Falls more than once and from different points of view. Since Bartram's visit in 1741, people had begun to visit the falls, and walkway ladders and a spray house for onlookers marred the wildness of the place. Cole painted out these man-made elements. He wanted viewers to know it in its original state. He would do this time and again, bringing his audience back into what was even then the disappearing world of the American wilderness. Cole was also a writer, a poet, and a musician. He loved music and played the guitar and flute. Friends would gather in his studio at Cedar Grove for a musical evening. His sister Sarah, an artist in her own right, was often his companion. Cole's desire to protect the beauty of the wilderness made him an early champion of the preservationist movement. Cole's friend, George Pope Morris, had written a poem later set to music, "Woodsman, Spare That Tree." Cole's influence in art was epic. His student, Frederick Church, would famously memorialize the American landscape with Niagara. Alfred Bierstadt would give that idea even greater physical power in paintings that captured the enormous panoramas of the American West. Art could also be local and simple. This whimsical mermaid came from the hand of Greenville artist Mary Ann Wilson. She too would achieve national fame. Her series on the prodigal son satisfied the needs of people to visualize the Bible's lessons. Not only the American landscape, but the first American novels centered on the Catskills. James Fenimore Cooper set Last of the Mohicans in the Northern Catskills. Washington Irving wrote Rip Van Winkle and also placed it in the Northern Catskills, a fable-like adventure whose popularity has never dimmed. Although Thomas Cole despaired of man-made intrusions, his landscapes opened people's eyes to the beauty close at hand. The mountains were within reach of New York City, and people began to come. It was not an easy trip. A day or more by sailing sloop, and then many hours up a winding mountain road. The destination was worth it, though. The first and greatest hotel in the Catskills was the Mountain House. It offered luxury accommodations in the midst of the wilderness, and that, as much as anything, was part of its appeal. The idea of a mountain house came to Charles L. Beach, whose family ran a stagecoach line. He bought a simple inn on the front range of the Catskills and rebuilt it into a palatial hotel. During the day, people hiked and enjoyed the views. In the evenings, people played cards, listened to music, and dressed up for costume parties. There was, however, no alcohol served. Drinking was a very public social issue. Cartoonists never tired of reminding people of the perils of drink. Charles Beach and the Mountain House made its first real competition in a wealthy Philadelphia lawyer, George Harding, who came to dinner with his family and ordered fried chicken. The Mountain House had certain meals on certain days, and there was no chicken that day. When Harding called Beach himself to the table and demanded it, Beach replied, "If you want fried chicken, I suggest you build your own hotel and serve it every day." Harding did just that. And he built it almost twice as big as the Mountain House. 800 rooms, the biggest wooden building in the world. Finished in just 2 years, it was elaborately furnished and decorated. Its food was superb, and you could always order fried chicken. Competition came from other new hotels as well. In an unwitting alliance, Thomas Cole and Charles L. Beach had invented American tourism and the summer vacation. The numbers of people that came to the Catskills was a phenomenon. Steam had replaced sails on the river, and railroads had replaced many stagecoach lines. But it was a long ride up the mountains from Kingston on the Ulster and Delaware Railroad. There was no way to come directly from Catskill except to Palinville at the foot of the mountains on Charles Beach's Catskill Mountain Railroad. Then Beach found the way. He invested in the Otis Elevating Railway. People arriving at Palinville could step directly onto a tram that would carry them straight up the mountainside. Taking the tram with its stunning aerial views was one of the thrills of a trip to the mountains. For centuries, the river was the main artery of life in the Hudson Valley. But schedules were subject to tides and the wind. Robert Fulton's Clermont changed everything. The age of steam introduced regular schedules and large passenger liners. Steamboat companies fought to serve Catskill with its busy tourist trade. Competition pushed prices down. You could travel from New York City to Catskill on a liner for $1, spend a week at a good hotel for $10, and a modest one for $5. Steamboat captains loved to race, tying down safety valves on their boilers so they could go faster. Passengers concerned about exploding boilers were assured that the boat had no boilers. There were countless accidents. Boilers exploded. Boats collided and passengers drowned. A very famous wreck was the Swallow. It happened in the Athens Channel one snowy winter night in 1845. The ship was racing and ran into a submerged rock. People drowned within sight of the shore. For most people, water travel was local and slow, across river or up and down short distances on local ferries. It was an age when time was measured not in hours, but mornings and afternoons. A second generation of dayliners arrived. Some of these were huge in size and could accommodate 1,000 passengers. You could now get to Catskill from New York in a few hours or overnight. And you could do it in style. Greene County had a score of homegrown heroes over the years. Captain Jacob Dunham was the Indiana Jones of his day. He ran the British blockade in the War of 1812 to carry goods to Rhode Island and Virginia. He then made a run for salt to the Caribbean, fell in with a privateer named Mitchell. Together they pillaged the Spanish island of St. Andrea. Dunham was later captured by local Indians but escaped. He sailed abroad again and was captured by Portuguese pirates, robbed, beaten, and set adrift. His last ship sank and he died penniless, but his story lives on. Most people found their adventures at the Barnum and Bailey Circus and Sideshow when it came to Catskill and Cairo. Barnum was a master of exaggeration, saying, "People like to be humbugged if it's fun." His humbuggery reached great heights with the shortest man in the world, General Tom Thumb. There was also a Mrs. Thumb, and they produced some little thumbs. The general came to Catskill in a miniature chariot drawn by tiny horses, performed skits about Napoleon and the Greek gods, and danced polkas and hornpipes in a total of 15 different acts. But Barnum's greatest marketing success was Swedish soprano Jenny Lind, who arrived here in a time of great national need. In 1851, Greene County came in numbers to Albany homes and concert halls to hear the Swedish Nightingale.
This evening, I will sing the very popular American song, Home, Sweet Home.
The whole country lay in the shadow of impending civil war. Jenny Lind's Home Sweet Home recalled a world without hardships, as did the newly issued Courier and Ives images of an idealized country life.
There's no place like home. There's no...
The men of Greene County would play a decisive but little-known role in the most crucial battle of the Civil War, Gettysburg. In October 1861, Greene County volunteers returned to the war as Companies G and K of the 20th New York State Militia. They fought at Bloody Antietam and the Second Battle of Bull Run. Their colonel, George Pratt, son of Zadok Pratt, was killed there. At Gettysburg, Companies G and K captured and held the Harmon Farm, where Confederate sharpshooters had been picking off Union artillerymen on McPherson Ridge, the main Union position. These are some of the Greene County men that made history that day. The Confederates had seen the 20th New York fight at Antietam and Bull Run and hesitated to advance. It cost General Lee's coming offensive 1 hour, an hour, it can be argued, that may have decided Gettysburg and the end of the Civil War. Many years later, some of the 20th New York reunited. Their regiment started with 1,000 men and ended with 375 still standing. As the century wore on, Greene County women began to expand their horizons, whether they kept house or had the leisure to do other things. For Helen Rowe Metcalf, who was born in Catskill, other things became an interest in textiles that led her to found the Rhode Island School of Design. An interest in design also inspired Candace Wheeler, a farm girl who would achieve fame as a designer with Lewis Comfort Tiffany and would also be the first successful woman interior decorator. In the post-Civil War years, Wheeler put middle-class women who had lost their husbands to work doing decorative arts that were successfully sold to the public. Candace Wheeler brought her success back to her roots and built America's first art colony, the Onteora Club in Tannersville. The Onteora Club created a holiday retreat for artists, staged events, and entertained everyone in sumptuous fashion. Maud Adams played Peter Pan on the club's impromptu stage. Mabel Mapes Dodge wrote the classic story Hans Brinker and edited St. Nicholas magazine. The widow of General Custer, herself a celebrated author, came to play at one of the many make-believe parties. Costume parties were the club's signature entertainment. The most popular visitor was Mark Twain with his prickly wit. He remarked that the club inn had walls so thin, you could hear a lady in the next room change her mind. Never shy, he and his daughter Susie did a cross-dressing performance as Hero and Leander. Candace Wheeler came back to the Catskills out of her love for the art of Thomas Cole. But there was another inhabitant who held the public's imagination even more intensely. No other entertainment in the 19th century was as popular as the tale of Rip Van Winkle. Famous actor Joseph Jefferson took the story to the stage.
Joseph Jefferson was on summer vacation down in the Poconos in Pennsylvania, and he picked up some of Washington Irving's books one day and was reading Irving's story of Rip Van Winkle, and he thought to himself, that would make a good play. And he went back and he interested his backers, and they did do a version, and it went over extremely well. Of course, don't forget, it was in a less sophisticated era of time, but folk art, I think, is always interesting to people, and each generation sort of renews its interest.
Jefferson's production, and later his son's, toured the nation, Europe, South America, Australia, and New Zealand, in a run that lasted into the 20th century. Jefferson brought the play to Catskill at the new Nolita Theater. Palinville and Catskill fought over the right to call Rip a resident. Crusaders wanted Rip as their champion. The temperance movement asked Jefferson to turn Rip into a teetotaler. He said he would, if Cinderella went on strike for higher wages. People couldn't get enough of Rip, and George Bristow set it to music as an opera.
We'll banish gloom till morning come.
The libretto replaced elves with night fairies that put Rip to sleep and day fairies that awakened him.
This night shall glee triumphant be. My name is Rip Van Winkle. What it is now, I do not know aright.
What didst thou say? Who speaketh once again? Tell me who thou art, but I would fain believe thou art my father. Can it be I heard aright?
Thy father? Let me see. There's something in that voice and face I know. Each moment to my mind they clearer grow. Tell me thy name.
Alice Van Winkle is thy name.
Alice, thou art mine, my only daughter. Oh, my dearest child, come to thy father's arms, I shall go wild.
The opera gave Washington Irving's fable a new look. The operatic Rip was not shy but outgoing. Handsome, not homely. A hero, not a victim. He, like Greene County itself, had grown up and out. The essence of this history is that people here have always connected to the world. We can't explain it. Like Rip, we can only be grateful and remember.
This program was produced in tribute to Greene County historian Raymond Beecher.